America is essentially a dream.
A little bit. You did some research on the Persian Gulf War itself and some of the conditions that these soldiers were under. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what the military recruiter is not going to tell the recruit about if they do go to war?
Well, they won't. They often will tell you that you're not going to war. I mean, and that was a common ploy that they used, especially up to the Gulf period. They said that joining the military, you were going to get skills and you were going to get education, and it had nothing to do with war, that it was a peacetime military. So they basically assured these people they wouldn't go to war. Secondly, in the Persian Gulf War, they didn't draw as they had historically from the active duty troops. They drew instead from the reserves, in many cases people who had already done their active duty and were in immobilized reserve units, you know, what they call standby reserve. So these guys, even though they had an 8-year commitment on paper, never thought that they'd see the military again. They were done with their reservist drills, you know, they were out of the picture, and suddenly they start getting mobilization orders. When they put the mobilization orders in force, they changed the regulations to say that unless it was an absolute severe hardship or a medical problem, no other discharge claim had to be dealt with. And so what happened was that they had a huge number of people who resisted going into the war. Gays and lesbians in the military that were in the reserves and were being mobilized came out and said, I'm gay or lesbian, and their response was, go over there, fight the war, come back, and then tell us about it. When they want warm bodies, that's not an issue. They also had a tremendous resistance from African Americans who did not want to kill other people of color, and especially the Muslim community said that they didn't want to go and kill other Muslims. They had more conscientious objector applications at the beginning of Desert Shield than they had during the height of Vietnam opposition. And thousands and thousands of these people were applying, but in many cases, the command said, well, we're not required under the mobilization regs to take this discharge application. So we're ignoring it, and we're sending you down to the rifle range to get you trained and ready to go over to the Gulf War. So, of course, some of these guys resisted. They refused to do that, or they refused to get on the transport planes. And in many instances, they were beaten and shackled and thrown onto the transport planes and taken to Saudi against their will. In Vietnam, even if you had orders cut for Vietnam and you claimed to be a conscientious objector, they would cancel the orders. But in this situation, they went back to treatment like they had in World War I for conscientious objectors, where they had absolutely no rights, and they just tried to bully them into the war theater. We got information from people over in the Gulf when they came back that there were makeshift prisons created in Saudi for the resistance in the field, and that there were 3,600 African Americans locked up in Saudi prisons, and then probably given bad discharges and, you know, summarily booted out. We also heard from people on the front line, and they told us that the front lines looked like Vietnam, almost all black and Hispanic with white officers in charge. We were also told that up until the day that the troops actually went into Kuwait, because they were along the Kuwait border for a long time before they actually went in and engaged. And you may remember that there was a controversy that went on saying that, you know, they wanted to know why so many troops were massing along this border, and they said that they were doing it in response to Iraqi troops along the border. But then the Russians reported flying over in the satellite photos that they didn't see any Iraqi troops anywhere near them, that there was just this huge massing of American troops there. So they knew they weren't in trouble. You know, they weren't under any imminent attack. And in light of that, what they did was, fearing that the troops would revolt, as they had in Vietnam, and turn the guns around on the officers, until the day they actually went to engage in Kuwait, they didn't issue them any live rounds. Then, because they know that body counts is a problem, and as those go up, the opposition to the war would grow, they developed a strategy that I believe was a direct war crime when they actually went to engage in Kuwait. they had taken the youngest conscripts, the 16, 17-year-old conscripts, not the Republican Guard, but just the chaff of the military, and put them up in trench warfare lines all along the desert in front of the American troops. So these kids are down in the trenches. Well, they moved forward with tanks and other equipment as a line toward these trenches. They put helicopters into the air that have these guns that will fire like 3,600 rounds in a second, and just blanket lead across a given area, and they started firing down into the trenches, and the people started trying to put up white flags, and they specifically shot at anybody that was trying to surrender. That was one of the things that Timothy McVeigh was known for in the Gulf War, was being somebody that would shoot at a white flag. But that was common, that they would go after the people who were trying to surrender. So they wouldn't let the troops surrender. They shot into the trenches and kept them trapped in the trenches with this massive fire. Meanwhile, the tanks put earth movers on the front, and they also had plows, and they pushed the desert sand forward and buried the people alive. And then the troops, and this was in the Washington Post, the troops marched behind and talked about seeing arms and hands wiggling of people still dying in the sand as they were marching over them. And, I mean, if you'd think the Vietnam vets had some traumatic stress disorder problems, I think some Gulf vets are going to have some nightmares, too. But, I mean, to me, this is directly just a war crime. I mean, the people trying to surrender, and they bury them alive, and then march the troops through. But they defended them on the grounds that none of the U.S. troops were shot.
Now, that's the psychological part here. What about the actual physical impacts of the Gulf War, specifically the Gulf War syndrome that we hear?
Well, I worked with a group called Service Members, like it was Families of Service Members Military Support Network, and they had about 2,000 families that had come together, families of GIs during the Desert Shield period, trying to press on Bush that they shouldn't go into war, that they should, you know, resolve it through other means. Then when the war started, they were trying to back up the family members and protect them. And what we started to see was a pattern coming back, that we were getting reports from all over the country through this central network of all these families that knew about the GIs, that the people were coming back. And in the first few weeks after they came back from the Gulf War, we had reports of several hundred people around the country who died of a wasting disease, where they lost tremendous amount of weight and then died within a week to 2 week period after they came back from the Gulf. We also got reports of tremendous levels of miscarriage, much higher. And then we found out that the women were all in the Army were all brought back to one base, and they were given sheets of paper that we got copies of, telling them for a 6 month period they shouldn't get pregnant or try to have a child. So the military knew that they were doing something. You know, and these were the ones that were impregnated while they were over there, were aborting or miscarrying when they were coming back, and the military just covered it up. They said they had checked into the miscarriages and there was no difference in the percentage and blah blah blah. But we had hundreds of people reporting this all over, and they had given them a specific instruction not to impregnate. So I think they knew that they had endangered their reproductive systems with whatever they did to them. Our analysis at that point, we pointed at four things that we thought were responsible, and this was right at the end of the war. And we held the first press conference on these deaths and, you know, sicknesses that people were coming back with. And what we looked at were the oil fires, and we didn't know there was any one or a combination of these things, but the oil fires polluting the air. Because a lot of people complained about not being able to breathe. And secondly, there were these untested experimental drugs that were given to these people that had not been tested on humans before. The FDA signed a waiver for battlefield purposes. They refused to let the GIs have any even informed consent. One GI's family sued in court for informed consent. And they said, when you're on the battlefield, you just do whatever you're told, and you don't need informed consent. If the military thinks this is a good drug for you, you take it. So they took these untested drugs. Progesterone, I think, was one of them. But anyway, they were supposedly prophylactic or protective against chemical biological warfare. And we believed that there were toxicities in those drugs that, that probably was leading to the sickness. We asked them to release the names of the units and the members of the units that were injected or given the drugs, and they said that that was top secret information. It was order of battle. And that's the same thing that they hid for 30 years in the Agent Orange files under the grounds that it was, you know, that was revealing their battle secrets to tell who they sprayed. And then we said that a third possible candidate was the leishmaniasis, because it's a disease of the blood that you get from sand fleas, and there was a general order out to all troops returning from the Gulf that they not give blood, like not go to blood banks and give blood because of the leishmaniasis that was in the blood. And then finally we thought that the depleted uranium shells might have been something. They have these shells that are made out of basically the spent uranium rods from nuclear reactors that are shut down, and rather than, you know, put them in a waste dump or not knowing what to do with them, they became utilitarian. They coated them with lead because uranium is the heaviest metal, and as a projectile going fast, it will penetrate any other known metal. So they were a great idea for a tank penetration cell. So they coat these things in brittle lead, they hit the tank, the lead breaks off, and the exposed uranium is still radioactive, and there were the open radioactive shells lying all over the battlefield. I also got a hold of the military training film for what to do if your friendly fire hits you and you get your own tank gets hit by one of these things. Well, the first thing they tell you is if it doesn't immobilize the tank, you're to continue with your mission. And the second thing is if any of the radioactive material is visibly sprayed inside or outside the tank or anywhere near you, you're to use duct tape and cover it up. And then after you finish the mission, then somebody will come with a radiation counter and see if they think the thing has to be detoxified. But you and how much you get radiated isn't the issue. And it never is. I mean, GIs are a government issue. They're owned by the military, and they're guinea pigs, and they use them, and they don't care what their health is going to be before or after the war. And so then they got themselves in the same position with Agent Orange, where they didn't want to pay off all these claims, so they had the VA say they would treat the individual symptoms. Then they did a study, and they said, oh, there's no one single cause that can be, you know, that can be the Gulf War syndrome. Well, we never said there was one single cause. We said that there were a number of potential causes, maybe combinations of causes. So it's disingenuous to say we can't find a single reason that's causing all this disease. Maybe there's multiple reasons. Another reason came out recently that's being speculated on has to do with the diet sodas that were sent over there, because the aspartame and the fake sweetener that's put into diet sodas at a certain level of heat turns into a close chemical cousin of formaldehyde and is quite toxic. And we know that these sodas were, you know, left out on the hot tarmac in the desert and before they were re-refrigerated and may have chemically altered. And so that's a new theory about one of the things that may be causing the sickness. But there's very definitely sick vets from the, you know, from the Gulf War, and they aren't dealing with them.
I have two more questions here before we end this interview. One of them is, you've said before many times that these wars are planned 20 years in advance. Why do you say that?
Well, I know they're planned well in advance. My mother was a Pentagon employee, a civilian employee of the Pentagon for 30 years, and she became the highest paid woman employee at the Pentagon. She was directly under the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Deputy Chief of Staff for Personnel Office. She was a manpower analyst, and her job was to project the overall national draft call figures for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. How did she do that? Well, she had basically like actuarial tables to project how many would retire, how many would reenlist, how many would discharge under each category, how many would enlist anew, and then she was given a current force level figure that was known, and a projected future force level figure where they wanted it, the force level to be, whether it was up, down, or stasis. And in that intervening period, she had to project how many people that they would then have to conscript on top of the enlistees in order to meet those force levels. And she had to project that figure accurately within 100 people either way on an annual national call. Now you're talking about a call of maybe 50,000 people. She had to be right within 100 people either way in projecting how many exactly they would need. And she did it. And remember my mother sweating each year the figures from before coming in. And she not only had to be that accurate, she had to be that accurate 5 years in advance. 5 years ahead, she had to come within 100 people either way of how many they had to draft in that given year. Then she told me that the figure that she came up with had to be multiplied by five, and that five times that figure would then be sent as the quota to the selective service system. The reason for that is that they knew that 50 to 55% would flunk the physical, 10 to 15% would meet a deferment or exemption category. Another 10 to 15% would no show, would resist, and then they were back to the original 20% they wanted in the first place.
Incredible.
All right. So, I mean, this is done, and they knew also figures that she was given that went higher than her. She was five levels above top security. She had access to the war room for briefings. But there were people at higher levels, up to 15 levels above top security. Ellsberg said he got, you know, up that far. And there were people at higher levels in an office of planning at the Pentagon who planned out wars. And they would give her figures for her actuarial table if they were going to war of how many would die in the war, how many would be disabled in the war and be, you know, taken off the battlefield, how many would die in the war, depending on the kind of war. Was it a guerrilla war? Was it a, you know, traditional military war? Was it a short war, an air war? They had already figured out from their experience of war up to that point how many they expected to lose, what the attrition rate would be. So I asked her, given all that, and that that was her job, 3 years after she retired, after 30 years at the Pentagon, she retired in 73, and I asked her, when did they tell you they would escalate the war in Vietnam? Because she had to be among the first to know in order to put the figures in. She said it was very strange what happened in Vietnam. She said for the first time in her career at the Pentagon, in April of 1963, she was told to change her projections, and she said they had never that had never happened before. And she said it was based on a White House order from Kennedy. And that Kennedy had told the Pentagon to change the projections for a full withdrawal of U.S. American troops from Vietnam by the end of 1964. This is April of 63. She put those figures in, and I said, well, then when did they tell you they would change back and escalate and go into the war? She said, late November of 63. I said, the last week, Kennedy is shot on Friday the 22nd. She said, the Monday following the assassination. Literally, Kennedy's just about in the grave. And they gave her figures to project for a new war, an escalated war. I said, was this a few more advisors? She said, I couldn't believe the figures. I took them back to the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and I said, these can't be right. And I used to tease her later that that was the first civilian protest to the war. They told her on November 25th, 1963, to project a 10-year war with 57,000 American dead, exactly on target. So yes, they plan the wars, they know where they're going. Robert McNamara, in his recent book, Retrospective on Vietnam, admits, he doesn't give the figure, but he admits that they knew that it was going to be high attrition and that the costs were going to be very high for the war, but they went ahead with it anyway. But they knew exactly how much it was going to cost and what it was going to take them. What our protest to the war stopped was not the war in Vietnam. That went ahead as planned for the 10 years. We stopped a broader war. Into Laos, into Cambodia, and eventually possibly even an engagement with China in the whole sector. Because our organizing at home led eventually to organizing in the field by GIs, and they could not continue the war. The GIs began to shoot the officers, and they began to refuse in whole units in the field, and they had a revolt going on in Vietnam. And they couldn't contain it, so it was cheaper for them and more reasonable for them to draw back the military from the wider war and not go ahead, abandon that plan, salvage what they could, but at least have a military that they could work with, hopefully.
John, you're a world of information. I'm going to ask you one final question here. We've been talking about recruiting of youth into the military. You're in Washington, D.C. It's a strange school district that you're in there. You are active. What are you doing there specifically as an activist, and what's the future look like?
Well, we went to challenge the presence of the junior ROTC. I would go first to public meetings of the school board, and people would stand up and say, we don't have textbooks, we don't have this, we don't have that, we've got all these needs in the school, and the school board would say, we don't have any money for this, and we don't have any money for that. And I would get up and say, I know where you can find a cool $500,000, you know, get rid of this military social club and recruiting process that you're paying for, you know, and spend the money on education. You know, and of course they weren't happy with me, but the crowd liked it, and we got enough opposition going, and then I actually brought people in to testify, first to a committee of the school board, and then to the school board as a whole, and also we testified to the Education and Libraries Committee of the D.C. City Council. And both those bodies voted in the committee level and on the whole level to get rid of junior ROTC. But at that point, the city was not run by our democratically elected school board or city council officials. It was run by a financial control board and their appointed board of military generals and retired military trustees. And they ignored the decision of the school board and in the elected process. So there was no way, and I said this to Mayor Berry at one point, I said, outside of going out in the street and rattling a can for the voices of the Democratic people in D.C. to be heard, because there was no way for anybody to make a decision that meant anything when it could be totally usurped by this appointed control board. And so, you know, and I said that instead of flummoxing about getting these decisions that were ignored, that he should initiate referendums. And then we could hold a referendum and show that 80 or 90% of the residents of D.C. wanted a particular thing, and then let the Financial Control Board go against it. At least it would be shown clearly that it wasn't representing the people who lived in the city. But he said, oh, that takes a lot of work. You got to get 10% of the people to sign a thing for the. I said, well, you're the mayor. I mean, if you can get 10% people out to vote for you, couldn't you get them out to sign the referendum? But then, you know, he went on to another question. So, but they don't. I mean, it's not only the Congress and the government, you know, at the top that don't want democratic rule. It's basically anybody that's in the positions of power don't want the people to rule. The idea of a representative democracy is bankrupt. It dates to the 1700s. It dates to a period where the only way you could be represented at a meeting or have any input was to put somebody on a horse and buggy and go there, but it took 2 days to get there or 3 days to get there. But otherwise, you wouldn't hear what happened and your point of view wouldn't be represented. So you'd pick somebody to go to the meeting, probably the person you liked around the least, and send them off and go back to the crops and do what you're doing and hear back later. Well, we live in the 21st century now. You know, we have instantaneous communication and almost instantaneous travel. We don't need representatives to go in a horse and buggy, which is now a stretch limousine, to pretend to represent us when we have a huge society, when they couldn't possibly represent everybody, when you couldn't represent me and I couldn't represent you and I don't want to. They don't even, after they're elected, they take the position that they are the people, and if you don't like them, you can elect somebody else. And so you're all you have at any given juncture is the evil of two lessers to choose from. You don't have any democratic control over the decision-making. You put in somebody that represents money, which made it possible for them to run in the election in the first place, and you pick, you know, one of those in a vote, and that's supposed to be democracy, you know, because they let you vote and they let you wail, but they write the laws. And they make the decisions, and you live with whatever they do. And they don't represent you. They never come to me in D.C. and say, what do you think about this issue, so I can represent you properly. They don't care what I think about the issue. And we have the technology now to have, instead of that, to have referendum, to have direct participatory democracy, and to open up the media for full debate on issues. I see. But what I'm saying is that you can do grassroots organizing, but at some point you've got to break the lock on the schools and on the media and on the decision-making in the society, because we live since 1947 in a national security state where our history has become a commodity of the state and stolen by the state. We don't even know how we got here. You know, they stopped teaching history in high school. When I was in school, you were lucky to get to the Civil War in history. I was in college before I got to World War II. I never got past World War II to really understand the forces that get us into the current situation that we're in. You know, and you don't want to read the textbooks now about the 60s or, you know, you don't want to read them. nothing, just pure propaganda.
No history, you know, at all.
Either. No, no history. Well, their history, but, you know, nothing resembling reality. And, you know, they don't teach it, so, and people are made instead to feel powerless while they're told they live in this wonderful democracy. A friend of mine in San Francisco wears this wonderful button that says, keep quiet, consume, and die. And that's the message. That's what they want you to do, and they want you to be happy about it, too. And they certainly don't want you to tarnish these wonderful rights that you have in your wonderful Constitution by actually using them. You know, that's to cheapen them. You should just be happy that you have them on paper and leave them alone.
Don't ever try to use them, though.
That's right, because you're just sullying them. You know, I mean, they're pure, and you should just be delighted that they exist. You know, but once you go out and try to have free speech or try to influence, then you're getting in the way. You know, and you know you're not really being a happy, democratically ruled person. But, of course, it has nothing to do with democracy, because democracy would be a system where everyone that's affected by a decision makes the decision. Well, you know as well as I do, that's not what happens in this country and hasn't happened for hundreds of years. But it's easier to blackmail, bully, bribe, or bullet 500 people than it is all of us. So instead, they make us afraid of each other. They make us trust the elite. I mean, I've argued this, and I've had people tell me that you couldn't trust the masses. The masses would make the wrong decision. My attitude is, I don't care if they make a mistake. The masses will fix it faster than that system will. You know. I don't say they're perfect, but I mean, I have a lot more hope in the general population than I have in the elite that run the country. The other thing that we need to set up is direct allocation of tax. If we're going to pay taxes, we should be allocating the taxes directly. And there's no reason not to do that, except that they want to manipulate it.
So when you say direct allocation of taxes, what are you referring to?
I would give people a pie that showed them how the current tax dollar is being spent and let them fill in a blank pie. How much do they want to go to the military? How much do they want to go to education? Plus, you could have a referendum on specific things that you wanted to fund. But what I'm saying is when you pay the taxes, you would allocate the taxes. You wouldn't have a representative allocate them, because I will bet you bottom dollar that if I tomorrow got all the tax addresses of taxpayers in this city and sent them out that kind of a pie and got a copy back from each of them and had them stick another copy in with their tax return in April, we either had any legal status, just tell the government, here's my tax and here's how I want it spent. I bet you bottom dollar that I could make up a pie based on the popular response of that survey, and I could put next to it the pie that's created by the voting record of their representative, and those would not match. And at that point, you could ask the representative to come out and tell you who it is that he's representing, but it isn't the people. All right, so the point is, but there's people that say, well, you don't know how. But if you don't know how, then you don't live in democracy. Democracy means that you have the intelligence to self-govern. And Jefferson said, if you can't, trust, he said, there's no ultimate repository for power or control or decision-making except the people. And if you don't trust the people to discretion to have that power, then inform their discretion. You don't take the power away, you inform their discretion. You have an informed democracy. So that's the other piece why the media, which is a commonwealth, it doesn't belong to the corporations by fiat, it belongs by license from a commonwealth. And that we should demand to basically tax the corporate airtime on electronic media. For every hour that they have, we should get at least a half an hour public time. And I mean really public, where things could be fully debated by all sides on an issue, and we could take 10 key issues a month and lay it out and debate them and get a referendum decision on them and have a way to communicate back and forth to each other about, what frames the issue and what it, I'm not talking, when I say public access, I'm not talking about national propaganda radio. I'm talking about community people from different points of view actually expressing what they think about something and having a full debate, and then inform people making a decision. The other argument I get to this is that people are apathetic. They'd never do it. Well, people are taught to be apathetic. The reason people don't vote in this country is that there's nothing to vote for. If they knew that by going and voting they could have the power to make a decision or be part of actually making a decision that directly affected their life, you can bet that they would be out there voting. But when all they have to vote for are these clowns that are put up in front of them that don't represent them and don't have any hope of representing them, then they become cynical. It's not apathy, it's disempowerment. And it's what they want. They want us to be disempowered. They don't want us to be making the decisions. They want to make them for us. And they want to make them behind closed doors. So what I try to do in D.C. or anywhere else is democratize any institution or situation that I'm in. And so I've tried to do that with the demilitarization of the schools. I mean, the future is not rosy by any means. I mean, but if people can be given proper information and awakened and enlivened and given a sense of hope, they can get that back. That's primarily, I believe, beyond all the political issues that were there, and they were there at the time of the assassination of Malcolm X, or the assassination of Robert Kennedy or John Kennedy or Malcolm X. The bottom line reason that they assassinated those people was that they represented hope. And it was hope that they were killing. It was empowerment that they were killing, because nobody after Kennedy responded to the public movements like civil rights or disarmament in the way that Kennedy did. That doesn't make him a saint. He was being pushed by powerful social forces, but at least he wasn't reactionary and pushing back like Bush, Reagan, and Nixon and the rest of them, and ignoring the people. And the other thing I'd say about it is that after Kennedy, there wasn't anybody who had enough brains to be worth blowing out.
John,
John, thank you for the analysis. It's been a delightful discussion, I always. This is Dave Fisher from Network X. We've been talking with John Judge, who is battling the militarization of our schools and our youth, and a longtime peace activist, researcher into the Kennedy assassination, worked with Mae Russell, and I'm very honored to have been able to interview.